Hello and welcome to the Moving Media Program here at the Somersworth Career Tech Center. I am so pleased to have longtime colleague and friend Paul Lally here, who is going to speak to you and to you about some little tidbits about what he's learned through a few years in this wonderful broadcasting business. Paul Lally, thank you for being here.
My pleasure, Bill. Good to be here. Good to be here. And good to be here if you're watching, and good to be here. Friends are here. Before I even get started, I wanted to, you all are familiar with what this is, or if you aren't, you might one night go up to an awards ceremony and they'll call out your name and they'll give you this. And do you know what that is? These are TV people. You pass it around, feel it. It's a nice heavy weight, isn't it? That's an Emmy. And you might be one of these days saying, thank you very much, I'd like to thank my et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And it's a recognition of having accomplished something that you didn't set out to do because you're doing what you're doing, but you end up winning an award and you get to take it home. You'll put it on the shelf in your dining room. And in the morning after you have your cereal, you can look over and see it shining and go, I'll be darned. That feels kind of nice. And that can happen providing you got to work in broadcasting to do that. And part of the reason why I'm here today is that I want to share with you a very workable method for you to actually get a job once you get out into the world of broadcasting. And I can tell you one thing, in broadcasting or in film or in media production, you almost never get a job where you answer an ad. You don't see an ad somewhere. And I'm going to tell you why. If I'm out on a shoot or I'm planning a film shoot and I have a sound recordist who can't make it, and I'll say, well, Jeff, who do you know? And he said, well, Ryan Barrett. I say, is he any good? I said, of course he is. Or Bill Strayer, he might work. So I get on the phone, I call Bill, he's busy. The rule is in television, if you're good, you're working. So it's hard to find somebody who isn't working. But I say, Bill, who do you know? And he says, well, you try Alan Green, he might be ready. What, can he handle a multiple camera shoot? Yeah, he can do it. Awesome, thanks. I get on and Green says, yeah, I got it, I'll do it. Boom. So I have a person. So what I've gone up to the mother tree and gone out to a branch, gone over here, and never once did I put an ad in the newspaper. I relied on people in a network that I have built over the years. And I started my career in television by not knowing how to do that. I just kind of fell into a job and it went down, da da da. And I worked my way up to be a producer and a writer and a director for Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood. Big deal job, hot stuff. I had like 10 years of, you know, riding high. One day they downsized and the full-time director position, writer out the window, and I went with it. And I went, whoa. It was like, you know, the Roadrunner cartoon that Wile E. Coyote runs off the cliff and goes, he's in midair. And he falls. So that's how I was. I went, oh my God, what am I going to do? I got to find a job. I have a wife. I got a couple kids. I got to support the family. So I was able to go to a company that sort of basically taught me what I'm going to tell you, a simple way today to how to do it. And it's just called networking. I'm sure you've heard of it. Networking will work if you want to be anything. Since I work in television, I can tell you in broadcasting and the media, it's a very closed family. You're going to find out that, I don't know how many million people live in America, 300 million or something. That maybe less than 5,000 people control that information. Maybe 10 of them. I can't imagine 10,000 people. Maybe 8,000 people, of which I'm somebody, and you could be one day. That a very small family of people really rely on each other to mostly protect your own job, protect the quality of your project. You can't take a chance. So what I learned is what I'm going to talk with you today about, and that is, you're out of school and you've learned, maybe you've gone to college, doesn't even matter if you have, but if you want to work in television, you want to work in broadcasting, that Woody Allen said, 95% of any job is showing up, number one. 5% is what you got to work on. So if you want to do it, that's what really matters. If you just really, it interests you and you don't even know why, you just feel led toward it, then listen to what I'm going to tell you. So step one is, you've heard the word resume till you're going crazy, but that is kind of essential. That's like a driver's license. And by the time you're out of college, you might have, you know, two or three little credits. I mean, it's nickel dime stuff because you're just learning. And what you want is a job, and that's the last thing you want to tell anybody when you go about this. Because what you don't want to activate is the mommy-daddy syndrome when somebody shows up. If someone calls me up and they're looking for work, oh my God, that's the last thing I want to hear. Because I have grown kids and grandkids, I don't want to feel like a bum because I don't got work for this person. So, you start off with the idea is that you want to talk to somebody like me, and you just want to talk to me. That's all. You want to talk to me what it's like to do what I do and why I like it, what's hard about it. And it's called information retrieval. You don't have to remember this, but that's really all you're doing, is you're getting information. And you want to find out. And the most important way to go about it is you got to make initial contacts. Email might work, but probably not, probably a note. Even in this day and age where everything's electronic, you're going to find that you still respond if you get a letter. I mean, if you get mail, that's like out of the ordinary. You'll respond to it. That I remember. Well, one thing, you'll draft just a note, however you get the information out. The lead sentence should be, "I'm not looking for a job." That way, you turn off my daddy instinct. I'm not going to work. This person doesn't want a job. I just want to talk to you for half an hour about what you do. Why? Because I want to work in this business. I want to do it. And I just want to spend time with you for half an hour. It might take you a few hits, but I guarantee you'll get a response, because everybody who works in broadcasting, radio, film, any of the media arts, everybody that works there, care if it's administrative, if it's sales, if it's production, everybody was drawn to that the way you're drawn to it in some measure. It's not rocket science, it's not being a biologist, you know, it's very unique. So everybody who works in it that you're going to encounter started the same way you did. And they're going to sense that. And they're going to notice where they remember what it's like. Now, I've been working for 40 some odd years, 1,000 years in broadcasting. But I remember what it felt like to really want it. And I identified it if you say to me, "I want to do what you do. You know, talk to me about it." And the most important thing is, you only want 30 minutes out of their life. And you keep checking it. You've got to get a watch if you don't have a watch. But sooner or later, they will come in. You're going to have two things with you. One is a resume. That's it. And it's not to get a job, but what you want to do is have them look at your resume. Just take a look at it. You bring a resume and your desire to work in this business, you get a job at any level. But you're not there to get a job. But you will get one, so just stay with me, because this works. I would say it's 100% success rate, because it's 95% of it is basically doing what I'm talking about. The other 5% is really wanting to work in this business. You got to really want it. And what'll happen is it'll work. So you go in, you sit down with the man or the woman who you finally agrees to talk to you for 30 minutes, and you chat with them. You talk back and forth. What did you like? How did you get started? And pay attention to the clock. And two, don't let them get too gassy, because what you want to do is get a human connection with them. And at the end of 30 minutes, say, well, probably I'd say 20 minutes in, you say, "I got a resume. I don't want a job." Just, you gotta keep doing that. Say, "Take a look at it. What do you think?" They're just going to look at it and say, "Well, looks okay. Do you have any suggestions?" Well, you might, whatever, just pay attention, whatever they say. What you've done is, first thing, you've exposed not only your desire to work in this business, but you're saying, here's my first card. Huh? You're going to be, 19, 20, 21, but you're going to do that. You're going to lay down your card. They're going to look at it, and that begins the dance. That whatever suggestions they make, saying, well, it looks okay. Well, thanks very much. Well, I notice, my time's up. We keep going. A lot of times they'll say, well, I said, they'll wave off the clock. They'll talk a little bit longer. But if not, saying, I'm going to head out. And this is the key thing. This is the third thing you do. Wanting to do it, a resume. And the last thing before you leave is there anybody who you could suggest that I could talk to? The same way that we've just spent time together. Is there anybody? They'll always know somebody. Helen Baker, she works at ABC News. You write down and you say, I'll do that. I'll contact her. Because they've just experienced someone sitting in front of them who wasn't panting, looking for a job. They were just, you were just saying, look at me, I want to do what you do. So they'll give you that name. And what you say is, do you mind if I mention your name when I can contact them? I've never met anybody who said no. So yeah, sure. Boom, you're done. Thanks very much. Love you. Never change. Up, out, gone. You go home. Go wherever you're living. And you're going to get him note cards and paper and pen and stamps. It sounds lame brain, but trust me. People love mail. By the time you're doing it, they'll still love mail. Okay? You're going to sit down and you're going to figure out what you're going to write first, and then like a two-sentence thanks. It's got to be handwritten. I don't care how crappy your handwriting is. But handwriting it's human. Like, this is human, okay? Thanks for the time. I appreciate it. And I'm going to follow up with X. Da-da-da. The end. And you mail that off. That's, you do that. You contact, and I can guarantee you, that's the hardest one you'll ever get is the first one. From then on, it'll open up. You'll contact dear Ms. Baker. Joe Palooka suggested that I talk to you. I'm not looking for a job, but I'm interested in broadcasting. Da, 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 da. And that's the first, and the gear shift, you've gone up to second gear. And she'll say, sure, come on by. All you do is repeat until you get work. Okay? Because what'll happen is when you finish with her, you'll say, do you know anybody? Da, 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 da. Well, I know. Da, da, da. Here's a key thing. Now I'm going to do my... This makes no sense, but I'll do my best. So you're following all this, I'm not going too fast. I'm trying to get you guys a job, so don't fight me, okay? All right, here's you. Here's the first one. Let's call him Basil, just because Italians eat a lot of basil. So you set your first meeting. He sends you to Ms. Baker, okay? And you say, do you know anybody, da, 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 da. She probably will know somebody that Basil knows, but here's the key thing. She's gonna know somebody that he doesn't know. And then you're on like I-95 instead of on Route 16. Because she's gonna send you to two places. One, that he's gonna know this person, but he's not gonna know this person. We're starting to do alphabet letters now, C and D, okay? Now you notice, all you're doing is repeating. You're repeating. She's going to send you to two. You'll meet with both of them. You already can see. Billy Wilder said in a good screenplay, let the audience do the 2+2. And you've already done it. You're going, okay. So I'm not going to spend the next hour expanding this thing. But what's going to happen is you will start to get this amazing, complex situation of connections. And all of them are going to have known you. And you're going to know more people than they do, because you've connected with them, you follow this little tree. Now, that being the case, you will have to spend money on stamps, because you're going to write your ass off keeping in touch with these people. Because what's going to happen is, once you meet with Ms. Baker, you thank her, and you're going to have to write two notes that day. Because then you're going to say, thanks, I appreciate it, I'm going to see Ms. D. And then you're going to write another note to Basil and say, thanks so much for sending me to that. It was very informative, just like a sentence. And I'll stay in touch. Da-da-da. So you see the two back. So you have to, you keep reporting back. And what's happening is you're starting to plant expectations in these people's heads of who you are. They're going to remember you. Because the glorious part is, up here is your first job. And mind you, in broadcasting or in media arts, you didn't answer an ad in the paper and get that job. You did it this way, because here's what's going to happen. That it's so funny that by the time you get to here, and this is going to be like Z, and you're exhausted, and you spent a lot of money on stamps, and you're tired of writing the same damn thing, all these people, that this person is going, they will have seen your resume, all these people, and I love this part. This is called Mr. Z talks to Ms. C. Mr. Z doesn't know who the hell Ms. He knows who Ms. C is, but they're talking one day, and but Ms. C, I just love this. There's an opening for a job. It's a production assistant somewhere, okay, and Ms. C says, I know this person that you might be interested in. And they throw you, you get a job, not because of Basil, not because of, you got a job because you did the hard work, and then they remember you, and then you get the job because they'll hire you. And you'll notice you don't answer an ad. They'll say, who do you know? Who's hungry enough to do this? All of these people at every level of media production have wanted to do what you do. Some of them have walked into it easy, some of them have fallen into it, but it's all luck. I had a student, a UNH student, whose uncle was like some big muggy muck in MTV music at the time. Big. He was so, I mean, he wasn't arrogant about it, but he didn't have any problem. I'm going to get that job. Of course, he didn't get a job. It didn't work out. And he thought he was going to cruise in, and they couldn't get a job. So he had to really scrabble for about a year because he had no preparation. But he got in finally. I have people who, there's a vice president at Universal Studios now who I taught, who did this little scheme, because it works, because I did it myself. I did it late in the game, because I didn't know that I had to do this. So once you get, and we're gonna wrap it up here, or circle back, that once you're here and you get that first job, that all these people deserve a note saying, awesome, I did it, ta-da, I did it, ta-da, my America, ta-da. In that, you can be, that can be almost a form letter. But everybody gets thanked then. And if you don't do this, you'll end up like I did, looking for work when Mr. Rogers' neighborhood downsized because I didn't keep up my connections. So you've got to do that. So that, and it can be every 6 months, that's all. Mark a calendar, say, oh, I got to tell them what I'm doing. But you'll do it because you're going to plant your seeds, because sooner or later, well, you'll get downsized, you'll lose your job, you want to move on or whatever. Well, where are you going to turn? Don't call me. Here's you, you're going to, they're all still there. Half of them have changed. The point is that they're here. You have a network. And since you've done it, you keep expanding. So you have a family that you've created. You've decided, and that's your decision. This is the way you do it. But you were down here saying, I had a good job. And you took that first step. And trust me, the people, everybody in here knows what it's like to have flop sweat, to be hungry, to be scared, not sure, and they understand that. And you can't hide that from people. What they want to see is your desire. When I started in television as a camera operator, and I remember the red light coming on, the tally light, I don't think they still do in cameras, but that tally light came on. And the first time I was operating a camera, it was a live show, and I was going like this. I said, if I move my camera a little bit to the left, that picture's going to move. And people at home, I'm going to have that effect on this camera operator. I almost fainted. It was so like head, like flipped me out, the whole idea. And I said, this is ridiculous. I can't. It sounds wacky to say that, but it was so thrilling. And I thought, oh, my God, this is, I want some of this. And it's so wacky, this job. I mean, nobody does this. I mean, really. That's a 9-to-5 is not at all like what broadcasting or media arts is like. It's very different and multi-layered interests from engineering to graphic arts to production to sales. It's very unique. And everybody who works in it had to get started somewhere. And a lot of them don't do this. They don't, you know, because you're going to have competition of the people coming out of the starting gate from Syracuse University or blah, 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 who think because they come from a hot college that they're going to get a job. Well, it doesn't work that way. What people want to see, and I want to see as a producer, is somebody who's hungry for it, who wants it. Because I'm still hungry after all these years. So I'm going to tail off a little bit. I want to just talk more about it. But so you're following the logic, though, okay? Right, thank you, right, thank you, right, thank you, right, thank you. And so, go for it. Question.
Thank you. Do you have questions for the business, for
anything?
How you do this?
Yeah.
Anything, but what his work, what Paul's work might have been like. There's a Monty Python sketch. It's called How to Do It. So how to, today we're going to learn how to play the flute and how to cure the world of all diseases. So how to play the flute, you simply blow in the little hole and move your finger up and down these keys. Now off to you, Paul. And Paul says that how to cure the world of all diseases, you simply discover something brilliant and then you can tell everybody what to do. So do you have any questions about how to be in the movie business?
Movies, film, yeah, I know all the stuff. I've written screenplays for Walt Disney. I've written novels, so I've done all that junk. So I know all that stuff. So talk to me. I don't have to hire you, see, that's the good part. I don't have to give you a job. Before you even ask anything, you're so, for me to sit here at this level, instead of a college level where you're senior saying, fuck, what am I gonna do? You are so ahead of the game, and you're gonna be, you know, you'll have your feet planted, you're gonna do fine. If you have an interest and it continues to grow, you're way ahead of the game because Bill is keeping, you know, providing this, and I think it's smart. So I didn't have that. So
what were your biggest moments of doubt when you said, I don't know if I can do this? Maybe when that transition happened at Mr. Rogers, or was it before that? And what brought you through those moments of doubt? Or did you never have them?
No. Well, a lot of times you'll say, who do I, I would think, who am I to do this? Who the hell do I? What gave me the right? But what I found is that one time I did a news series with, I did a news series. You don't remember, these are all famous news broadcasters back in my time, Walter Cronkite and Bill Moyers and the guy, you know, these were big luminaries. So I interviewed them on film for a series I did on news. And I got their interviews back in transcripts, and I pieced together the transcripts, and Walter Cronkite was a big deal. He was like a huge anchor, television news anchor, and I was reading the transcripts saying, this is so boring. What kind of questions did I ask him? What was I thinking? You know, and I can remember at my dining room table, I clipped out all these, you know, I'm trying to build the show with clips of all these people's names, and I remember being in the dining room saying, man, my ass is in a sling. What have I done? I've sold sizzle instead of a steak. Whoa! And I remember going into the edit room and I laced up the interviews onto film. It was a flatbed editor, and I put the Cronkite stuff and I put it up to that first bit where he made some comment, and I turned it on, and I watched it, and then I looked down at what he said. Then I looked at him again. I said, "Holy cow!" To see his face and talk and say what I just saw in cold print was transformational. I went, oh my God, all I could do was look at him. He was so powerful. I went, whew, my is not in a sling. I think I can do this. Because these people have a persona about them that I didn't know that. And I thought I was really doomed because I had promised the world on this series. But I ended up getting a gold medal at the whatever New York Film Festival. It was pretty scary because I used the power of the media to get out and do it. People will let you come in there, you know, if you come with a camera or whatever. It's a very rare privilege that what I call vertical mobility. You can go up and down the pole. You can talk with the Pope or a politician or a person looking for work or, you know, whatever, from the media, okay? It gives you great doors open up for you. And I thought, boy, I want some of this. Because I came from a middle, lower, probably more lower class background. So I didn't have but I knew I wanted to do this. And I said, give me some of this. I can't be a doctor or a lawyer, but I want to do a TV guy. What are you interested in doing? Do you know yet? For you? Yeah, surely, but what do you think?
Right now, I'd like to be somewhere in like news correspondent, sort of.
Yeah.
That's like the dream job right now.
Good. Yeah, keep dream jobs. Yeah, that's what you, go for. Yeah, follow your heart on that. And you'll not meet anybody who's on-air newscaster or journalist who hasn't done just that. They've wanted it. And yeah.
I would like to ask you what your favorite part of your job is.
My favorite part of my job, good point, is being when I'm in a studio environment, I'll wear a hat like you have. It mostly keeps the glare out of this. But when I was at Mr. Rogers Neighborhood directing, there'd be a lot of people running around stuff, and I would wear a hat. And I also wore it because they'd say, well, what about X? I said, ask the guy in the hat. So they could see the guy in the hat. And they would come to me. And it let me, I was totally responsible for everything's happening in the studio. All the cameras, all the engineers, the lighting, everything was on my neck. And I needed to be responsible for it. And that's what I like about it. The buck stops with me. Coming up through the ranks, I had lots of people who were really jerks. Directors, people who treated me, made me feel bad about myself. And one thing I can tell you, when you'll get into this, if you get into this business, you'll be around people who are not as open and gregarious as I am. And mostly, you try to remember that whether or not they're being jerks, for lack of a better word, and making you feel terrible. At bottom, what's driving them is they've lost control of what's going on. Number one. And you're looking at a person, when you lose control, you get afraid. When you get afraid, you get angry. And when you get angry, you can become a jerk. So what you're looking at is down there is someone who's lost control. And I watch that happen a lot. I've been yelled at by some pretty famous directors and made to feel terrible, but because they'd lost control. So that's why I said, when I get to do that, I'm going to do it my way. So I set the tone. My son-in-law's dad is a pilot, captain for United Airlines. And he flies 737s. He says, I like to be a captain because I get to set the tone of the aircraft, set the tone of the cockpit. And it just sticks with me nice. Bill sets the tone here. And I set the tone in a studio environment. And that's my favorite part, is to be the boss. Yeah. Because my neck's on the block, nobody else's neck. If you put your neck on the block, you show people, they won't chop it off. That's one thing I learned. A lot of people thought, well, it's art director was late with the graphics. To say, I don't care what went wrong. If I'm the producer, it's my fault. I'll take the hit. People will never kill you if you admit you're a jerk. It's true. I've done it. I've avoided death many times. Because I said, over here, I did it.
So, like, when you meet with these people, is that like a coffee shop or like at your house?
Oh, good, very good question. I would always meet in their office. Yeah, you want to come see where they work. And, you'll have to go through secretaries and stuff. But the key thing is you don't want a job. You want to it's really information retrieval. You want to find out. And if you do any kind of research where you can use media, to find out, networking, methods of networking to find a job. Based on what I told you today, sort of the specific broadcasting way of doing it, you'll be able to figure out a strategy. But I've always met with people on their home turf, in their office. And the key thing is watching your time and not taking up much of it. And it's amazing. Half the time they'll say, no, it's okay, go ahead, keep talking. So You go, so you give yourself another 5 minutes, and then you say, I'm out of here, you know.
I had a question. Your connections now versus when you were first starting out, what are those like, and kind of what has networking done for you?
For me? Well, it allowed me to just keep working. That I went from no job to learning how to network late in my career, and then getting what I have parlayed a good job. And so I think I answered your question, but that's network kept me, it kept me doing what I like to do, because I've cooked French fries at McDonald's. I've cooked them so hard that I couldn't make a fist when I got home, and because it's the only job I could get. And I remember I said, my God, this is hard, you know. So I've done all that stuff. I've carried mail, I work construction, and I know how to do all that, but it's networking to me. It also, this is a little more esoteric, but I want to share it with you. You're in a business that isolates people. You're either they're in front of computer screens or their phones, or they're sitting at home watching a 4x9 TV thing. They're isolated from the world. We're not isolated here. We're talking back and forth. We're being like humans, okay? Remember, humans. You're in a business that tends to isolate that naturally. So your job, I feel, let me order you around, your job. My job is to make it more of a community. I mean, I produce an Italian cooking series. So Marianne Esposito looks in the camera, and she tells you how to cook stuff. But she's looking in the camera like I'm looking at you right now. It's a subjective camera. It's very powerful stuff. I'm attracted to that because I think it does a couple things. One, it models when Marianne's cooking, she's happy as can be, doing her thing. When Mr. Rogers was doing his thing, puppets and stuff, he was having a blast. He loved it. What he was modeling was somebody doing something like they do. Okay. Cooking French fries was not something I liked to do, but I had to do it. There's a big difference between a job and work, and your labor versus thing. And Julia Child, a very famous chef who's long gone, said, you know, it's terrible if what you're doing doesn't make you, sounds wacky to say now, doesn't make you tremble with joy, but she meant it. She loved doing it. And as much as, you know, what you're doing now is you're doing something, you see some measure of accomplishment, you feel good about it. That's what this does. And what you're doing as a sidebar is you're building a community. But I'm glad that you're doing it, so.
Thank you, Paul.
My pleasure. My pleasure, pleasure. Thank you. So give it to me. Give it up. You guys are good.